But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are rubble now.
Great day it is to be in the house of the Lord today on this Labor Day weekend. We are glad that you have chosen on this Sunday morning to join us to worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. As we prepare our hearts for worship today, we want to encourage you that if you happen to be visiting with us today, take that Connect card that can be found in the back of your pew. On your way out today, we invite you to drop that in the offering plate. We just want to better connect with you and minister to you. We're excited that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. So let us begin by going to the Lord in prayer and preparing our hearts to worship his name today. I invite you, if you're able, to stand with me, and I will open us up in a word of prayer today. Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today, humbled by who you are. And we ask this morning, before we sing a note of praise, that you would search our hearts, O God. See if there be any grievous way in us. And Lord, if there's anything today that would keep us from honoring your name with our praise, Lord, we lay that down at your feet this morning. And Lord, we're asking today as we partake in the Lord's Supper, as we worship your name through song, and as we study your word, Lord, we ask that you would fill this place with your presence. Would you be magnified in the songs we sing? Would we be reminded of the sacrifice paid for us on the cross? And may we know you better and be challenged by your word today. Lord, we're asking you to do a great work. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We celebrate this morning because we are redeemed. Let's sing.
Redeemed how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. His child.
Good morning, church. It is a joy to be here this day that the Lord has made. And it's really special for me because this is the beginning of my 9th year as the pastor of Exchange Avenue. And what an honor. And it's kind of crazy to say out loud. And it's really special because I served at the first church I served at, I served for 4 years. The second church I served for 4 years. Now this is the third church I've served at, and it's 8 years. So half my ministry time has been given here. And my prayer is that the Lord would just allow us to continue to see His goodness and His grace here at this church for many years to come. And that we would have the opportunity to, if you will, pray heaven down to earth and watch Him transform this area for His glory. And so when I think about the time that I've been here, I just think about the goodness and the grace of God. Our God is faithful. Our God is worthy of our praise. And it is with that I just want to encourage you today to thank God for bringing you here this day. You're not here by accident. You're here because He has you here and you're in the right place. Psalm 90 says this, Lord, You have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever You had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, You are God. He is the one that we can hold. He is the one that we can trust. He is the one that we can wrap our arms around, not because of his blessings, though they're great, not because of his favor, though they're awesome. It's better to be in his favor and in his presence than anywhere else in the world, but because he is God and he is forever, that is why we praise him. So today we have an opportunity to gather as a family and sing praises to our King and glorify him and bring our worship to him because he's God. And so I just want to encourage you today, this morning, as we go to the Lord in prayer, and just worship him for who he is. Worship him for what he's done for you and exalt his name. Will you pray with me? Oh, Father, we come before you so unworthy to be in your dwelling place, so unworthy to be in your presence, but it's because of and by and through the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, that we have the opportunity to be ushered into your presence this day. And so we exalt, we worship, we praise Jesus because it's all about Jesus. For he is the one who paid our price on the cross. He is the one who defeated Satan, sin, and death. He is the one who is seated on the throne, and he is the one who is going to return. He is the one who has been given the name above every name, that when he returns, every knee on earth, every knee under the earth, and every knee in heaven will bow because his name is the greatest name. And we exalt him today because he's God. Jesus, it's all about you. We ask that the Spirit would be present in this place, leading us to conviction and repentance, so we may walk in righteousness. Lord, if there's anyone here who does not know you as their Lord and Savior, may you convict them and lead them to salvation this day that you have made. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
is heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. Cause when you call my name, oh, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Because of that this morning, and let us continue. This next song is one that we've known for a little while now. It's called Oh But God, and it reminds us of his rich mercy, that even though we were caught and dead in sin, but God, being rich in mercy, sent his son Jesus to die for us so that we may have life. Let's sing this morning.
I was buried beneath my rebellion, without hope of redemption, blind to my need for the Savior. Oh, but God, crushed by the weight of my failure, living the lie I created, digging my grave without knowing. Oh, but
my salvation.
You may be seated, and our deacons may make their way forward. This morning we get the opportunity to take part in the Lord's Supper. And it says this in Romans chapter 8, verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. Why do we remember the death of Christ? And why do we celebrate it like God told us to? Because it's all about Jesus. Because now as sinners, for all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, in and through Christ, there is now, therefore, no condemnation for who? Those who are in Christ Jesus. Amen? And so we who are in Christ Jesus this morning, we who believe in him, partake in this meal. So we take this meal as a confession, publicly professing the reality that Jesus died on the cross and he rose from the dead. And through his sacrifice on the cross, we have life and life everlasting. That is why we take this meal. It's to remind us of Jesus, his person, and his work. And so we here at Exchange, we practice what's called open communion, meaning this, that if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, we want you and invite you to partake with us. But if you are not a believer in Jesus Christ, we ask that you would just pass, wave your hand, and allow the deacon to pass you by so that you don't take this meal with us. This is just for the family. Because this is for us to remember the work that Christ has done on the cross for us. And so we're going to remember that by eating the bread and drinking some juice that represents the blood of Christ shed for us. But if you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, don't allow this moment to pass you by. For God loves you. And he lived the perfect sinless life to die for you. He went to the extreme that you may today have life and life everlasting. So if you do not believe in Jesus, or if you've yet to place your faith and trust in him, do not tarry. Do not wait. Believe in him today. Will you pray with me? Father, I thank you so much for this opportunity to take this meal, to confess our faith and our trust in you. Lord, I thank you for this church. I thank you for the 105 years of gospel proclamation that's been taking place here. And Lord, I ask that you would continue to help us persevere and help us to champion the faith that you have given us. And we celebrate Jesus, his person, his work, for what he did for us this day. Search our hearts, O God. See if there be any grievous way in us, and lead us in the way everlasting. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. that washing white as snow is the same words that Paul said in Romans 8 when he says, now therefore there is no condemnation who are those who are in Christ Jesus. Because when our sins have been washed white as snow, they are no more. Because of the blood of Christ, all of our sins, past, present, and future, have been covered, have been washed, have been cleansed, we've been cleansed, and we have been forgiven. And so as Christians, something to remember is that when the Lord forgives you, he forgives and forgets. And he tosses your sin, if you will, as far as the east is from the west. The challenge as Christians is to forgive yourself, not to identify yourself by your past failures, by your past challenges, by your past, but to identify yourself as Christ identifies you, as God identifies you, as a son and daughter of God, one who has the righteousness of Christ. That is the great exchange. The great exchange on the cross is Christ took your sin for you to have his righteousness. In other words, God no longer looks at you and put your name there, sinner. He looks at you, saint, with the righteousness of Christ. He no longer sees your sin, for it's been forgiven. He no longer sees your sin, because you've been cleansed. He sees righteous you, and that righteousness has been imputed to you, has been given to you through Jesus. That is why we celebrate his death, because it is by his death we have life. Before Jesus died, he was with his disciples in the upper room, and they were about to celebrate the Lord's Supper, or they were to celebrate the Passover, and he shifted it to the Lord's Supper. And so in that meal, they drink wine and break bread at different phases throughout the meal. And so he broke tradition, and he started this new tradition. And so he grabbed the bread, and he broke it, and he says these words, "This is my body given for you." So this little wafer that we have is a symbol of the body that has been given to us, broken for us, of Christ. So we remember the cost of our sin is the death of Christ, his broken body for us. Jeff, will you pray a prayer over his broken body?
Heavenly Father, God, we just praise you for the broken body. Father, we praise you as we had learned this morning and were reminded of this morning. When we're faithful, you're faithful. When we're unfaithful, you're faithful because you couldn't deny yourself. That's the picture here. You atoned for us because we couldn't atone for us. May we live our day-to-day life with that understanding that others may see. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper. And he said, "This is the cup of my new covenant in my blood." Angel, will you pray a prayer over the blood, the cup?
Padre nuestro que estás en los cielos, Señor, te damos gracias, Señor, por una vez más por estar aquí, Señor, en tu casa, Señor. Ahora te pedimos por este jugo, Señor, que simboliza la sangre que derramó tu Hijo Jesucristo en esa cruz por nosotros, Señor. Te lo pedimos en el nombre de tu Hijo amado, Cristo Jesús. Amén.
This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Father, we thank you for the death of Christ on the cross. We thank you for his sacrifice that he gave us. We ask, O Spirit, that you continue to move in this place as we continue to walk and worship in a worthy manner. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand as we continue? Let's sing, oh, praise the one who paid my debt. Truth this morning, and we're thankful that you have come to save the lost, and we're thankful for the price paid for us upon the cross to make that happen. And Lord, we pray that as we open up your word today, Lord, that you would speak to each heart in this place. Would you challenge us to know you more, to follow you? But Lord, if there's anybody here today that does not know you, we do ask that today would be the day of salvation. Lord, would you draw men and women to yourself? Lord, that's our prayer. Move in a great way. Speak through Pastor John this morning. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I invite you just for a brief moment to remain standing. Our children who are 4 years old through the third grade, this is their opportunity as each week to go to Children's Church. That will be in the children's wing, and they can be picked up there immediately following service today. They can go with Miss Crystal there in the back. As you're standing, Elise is going to read our passage of Scripture this morning from Psalm 111.
Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the inheritance of the nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. Psalm 111.
Amen. We are in our final, you may be seated. We are in our final sermon series in our summer series in Psalms. And so I hope you have enjoyed this series. We'll be getting back into our Acts series that we started in January. And we went from Acts chapter 1 through Acts chapter 7 in the winter springtime. So we'll pick up in Acts chapter 8 if you want to start reading in Acts 8. We'll be there next week. But this morning we are in Psalm 111. And so in this, basically this instruction, this psalm is an instruction for you. And so I don't know about your personality, but I tend to know about mine. And when you have children, you have to put a lot of things together. And when you're married, many things are purchased that you have to put together. And so I don't know about you men out there, but do you follow the instructions or not? And so if you follow the instructions, at times there's 10,000 instructions, especially if you buy something from IKEA or a store like that. If you don't follow the instructions, it's probably going to be put together backwards or sideways or leaning in one direction or another. I don't know if I'm on an island, but at times I put the instructions to the side. And I don't think, you know, it would be best if I actually look into this and discern what would be best. I think the most glaring example of this, I was helping my wife by putting together our treadmill on the third at our house, and I'm working on it, and I have two screws, the final two screws to put this bar on. And the two screws go in the only two holes that are present. And so a person like me would think, well, these screws have to go into these holes, which they did, but they wouldn't go. And so I then thought, well, it's not me who's putting this on wrong. The person who sent me these materials, they've made a mistake. Because I thought the thread count was off. So the threads were bigger. Anyways, what I didn't realize is I was trying to put the screws in from the front. The screws were supposed to go in from the back. And I tried my hardest, and it worked because I got a drill out. To put a square peg in a round hole. I haven't touched those screws since. She doesn't even know that this happened. I'm telling on myself. So there'll be some repentance and Hail Marys later. But when we don't follow instructions, we make mistakes. It's the whole point. And it's one thing when it's furniture. It's another thing when it's a car and you're driving. And a buddy of mine was on his moped and he was backing out of his garage and he thought, you know, today just doesn't feel right to not wear a helmet. I'm going to go put a helmet on. So he puts a helmet on. And as he's driving, someone decides to cut a turn really, 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 really sharp. And he ends up in a head-on collision. And his head hit the windshield. And by God's grace, he only walked away with a broken rib. But it's because he paused and thought, you know, maybe I need some protection here. You see, not all instruction is just black and white. You might have the ability to not wear a helmet, but is that wise? All instructions, when you're assembling something, are given, but you have the ability to follow them or not. And then throughout human history, God has given his people instruction. But unlike the instruction of man, God's instruction is actually, hey, I'm telling you what to do. You might think you have free will or the ability to say, no, God, I know better. But this is not how this relationship works. And so God has given us instructions, and it actually is for our benefit. Even though it might feel like we're being hemmed in, we're being hampered from doing what we want to do, we're being kept from the joy or the freedom of this world, but in reality, that perspective is enslavement to sin. Because what God says in and through his word is that when you come to Christ and you're free from the deception and the bondage and the enslavement to sin, you're now free to live for him. You're free to walk with him. Talk with him, know him, trust him, and obey him. In other words, you're free to follow his instructions. The question at hand is, do you or do you not? I know for some of us, we like to follow instructions and rules. And so as people who are like that in the room, we tend to be more legalistic or fundamental. And then there's others in the room who would rather never to look at the instructions, and they just want to push the boundary as far as they can, but not step over it. How far can I go and still be good, but still get away with whatever I can? And so there's different peoples and different personalities in the room, but we have one God. And he's given us instruction. And really, our God is saying to us this morning, I love you. I want you to be safe. I love you. I want you to be protected. I love you. And I don't want you to fall in the same traps and the pitfalls and the hardships that sin and its enticement will lead you. God is saying, I love you. Will you follow me? I love you. Here are my instructions. If you follow these, if you do these, you're showing that you're following me. When we think about instructions, sometimes we don't think about them in the sense of God's protection or God's guidance or God's love. But I want to encourage you today that in Psalm 111, that we will examine four instructions from God if we long to enjoy the help and the blessing of the Lord. Four instructions if we long to enjoy the help and the blessing of the Lord. So in the sermon last week, we were reminded, if you do this, then you'll have this. And if you don't do this, then this will happen. So basically, this is the if-then statement of Scripture. If you follow Jesus, then you'll have his blessings. You'll have his presence. You'll have him. If you don't follow him, you won't. And can I tell you something? In Scripture, there's no more dangerous place to be than when it says in the Old Testament, and Christ and God turned his face from his people. That is a symbol of him removing his presence. That is a symbol of him removing his protection. That is a symbol of him removing himself from them. The greatest thing that we can have in this world are not the blessings and the riches that God provides. The greatest thing that we can have is the presence of God in our lives. Do you believe it? These four instructions this morning will help us enjoy it. These four instructions this morning will help us as we are going through whatever season in life we are walking in. Because there are some of us who are on the spiritual mountaintop. There are some of us who are on the descent of challenge. There are some of us who are in that bottom valley this morning. But no matter where you are in your walk, no matter the circumstance that you find yourself in, our Lord is faithful, our Lord is just, our Lord is true, and his presence and his instructions are not independent of circumstances, are not dependent of circumstances. They're independent of it. Meaning that no matter where you are in life, you can depend upon God and should still exalt him in the same manner. Trust in him. Know him. Follow him. Abide. The purpose of this sermon is to examine four instructions from God if we long to enjoy the help and the blessing of the Lord. Will you pray with me? God, we thank you so much for this day that you've given us. We thank you for the opportunity that we've had to examine the Lord's Supper. I pray that you would be over this moment, this holy moment of preaching your word to your people. May you help edify. May you help instruct. May you convict. May you guide. For God, we need you. Oh, we need you every hour. We need you. We thank you for the blood of the Lamb that washes us and cleanses us white as snow. And I ask, oh God, that you hide me behind your cross, that these words would be your words spoken, words of life, words of truth, words of love. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So the first instruction that we have from the text of Psalm 111 is this, that we are to vow to worship and praise God at all times. Vow to worship and praise God at all times. This means that regardless of the circumstance or the challenge that we're going through in life, we vow, make it a determination in our mind that we will worship and praise God regardless. So think of Job in this moment. Job praised God when he had all his family, when he had all of his wealth, when he had everything. And then all of a sudden, everything was taken away from him but his wife. And she came running to him and said, curse God and die, how about it? And he says, no, naked I came into this world and naked I'll leave. But blessed be the name of the Lord. He said, it doesn't matter what happens to me, I will continue to praise God. Now, as the book goes on, did he start to question the Lord? Yes, he did. He did question, but he was humbled because God then says, who are you, Job? Were you there when I hung the world? Were you there when I did this? Were you there when I did this? Who are you, Job, to question me? And Job repents, and he worships God, even though he has nothing, even though he's covered with sores and has hardship and challenge, even though he's lost his family, his wealth, and he worships God. And you know what God does? He restores him. Gives him more family, more children. Gives him more possessions. But you know what the beauty of the whole thing is? It's not about the possessions. It's not about the gift. It's not about even the extended family that Job was given. At the end of the book, even through the challenge and the valley of the shadow of death, Job had God. And on the opposite side of it, Job had God. In this section right here, in Psalm 111, this is in a challenging point in Israel's history. And what this is, in verse 1, this text is saying, praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. This is actually, in Hebrew, a vow. I am vowing to give praise to the Lord with my whole heart. And I just want you to know that this is a hallelujah psalm. I am going to say and declare hallelujah to the Lord. I will praise him independent of my circumstances. No matter what is going on, I am going to praise the Lord. Not just with some of me, with my whole heart. This is all of me loves all of you, Lord, and I am giving you all of myself. With my everything, I worship God. With my everything. Meaning that when your thoughts and your opinions and when your feelings are even hurt by the Word of God, what are you going to put above the Word of God? Nothing. So if you read something in the text and it contradicts what you think or what you feel or what you desire and you're wrestling with it and you're like, what am I to do with this? You're to worship God by obeying his word. But that's hard. But that's why it's a vow. I vow to wholeheartedly, independent of my circumstances, in good times and in bad, I vow to wholeheartedly worship God. That vow is something that is done in private. That vow is something that's done each morning. And I hope that when you wake up in the morning, you give the day to the Lord. I hope that you spend time in prayer with God. I hope that you spend time reading His Word, allowing His Word to wash over you that day. I make it part of my routine in the morning to thank God for His mercies being new each day. And then on my way to the gym, I pray not only for my day, but then I pray for my testimony at the gym, that I might be a witness. It gets my mind thinking about how I might be a witness even while I'm working out. Because in every place and in every season and in every opportunity that you have throughout the day, you have an opportunity to be a witness to the Lord. A light in a very dark place. So it's us praising God by vowing to worship and praise Him with our life, not just coming to church on Sundays. Philippians 4:4 says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. We can't rejoice in the Lord always if we don't vow to rejoice to Him always. But notice the psalmist doesn't just make this vow independently and be by himself, but rather he does that, and then he goes where? In the company of the upright, in the congregation. So he now goes from private to public, and he wants to now praise and make this declaration with God's people. So he goes to God's court. He goes, if you will, to the temple, which if in our minds today, that's church, and he praises God publicly. What this does for us and what this means for us is there's something special and unbelievable about worshiping God in person together as a family of believers. I need you as much as you need me. And we need God. So we gather each week to help keep us all focused on Him. So the first instruction, let us vow to worship and praise God at all times. The second instruction is this: be strengthened by remembering God's great works. This comes from verses 2 through 6. Let's be strengthened by remembering God's works. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is His work, and His righteousness endures forever. He has caused His wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear Him. He remembers His covenant forever. He has shown His people the power of His works in giving them the inheritance of the nations. So I just want to hone in on this. Notice the character that is of God that is revealed by remembering God's works. The character of God that's revealed by remembering God's works. So these are described in this section of Scripture. We see great, we see glorious and majesty and righteous. We see wonderful and gracious and compassionate. We see powerful. When we remember the works of God, we see God. Because we see His character. He doesn't work independently of Himself. And some of the works that are mentioned in this psalm are God provides in verse 5 food for the Israelites in the wilderness. That's manna and quail. Verse 5, He provided His covenant at Mount Sinai. That's His relationship between God and man and God. And guess what? God has kept His covenant. Meaning His covenant has endured all generations because it's not dependent upon man, but rather it's dependent upon God. Verse 6 goes on to say that God's work of conquering the nations of Canaan, they were able to go in and capture Canaan with the power of God. They were given a land as an inheritance. Verse 9 even references deliverance from the bondage in Babylon. When we remember God's works, we get to actually see God's character. And when we're in a place of wanting to worship Him or needing to have our feet firmly planted on Him, when we remember Him and see His character, we are now fulfilled and readied and empowered to stand firm today. Because our circumstances are hard, are challenging, but we remember that God is great, that God is glorious, that God is majestic and righteous, that He's wonderful and gracious and compassionate, that He's powerful and faithful and trustworthy, that He's holy and He's awesome. Now, our feet aren't planted on something we don't know. Our feet are planted on God Himself. So the first instruction we see in the text is vow to worship. And the second instruction we see in the text is be strengthened by remembering. Remember His works. In the same way that we remember your salvation, in the same way that we, in our mind's eye, remember His specific hand in our life and the way that He just provides for us, those are banner moments in our life. And we are to remember Him, and that strengthens us for today. Let's see, thirdly, be encouraged by the awesome nature of God. This comes from verses 7 through 9. The awesome nature of God. It says this: the works of His hands are faithful and just. All His precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever, to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He has sent redemption to His people, and He has commanded His covenant forever. Holy and awesome is His name. Be encouraged by the awesome nature of God. And how are we encouraged by His nature? Notice how this goes. We vow to worship Him. We're strengthened by remembering Him. And we see His awesome nature revealed to us in His Word. So, like, what are some things that we just read in verses 7 through 9 that are awesome? That He is everlasting to everlasting. That He is upright. That He's just. That He's true. That He is trustworthy. His name is holy. This is a God that is worthy of praise. This is a God that we can trust and know. This is a God that we can depend on and rely on no matter what we're going through. And He reveals Himself to us not just in what He's done, but He reveals Himself to us in His Word, that we can know Him, follow Him, and obey Him. And so when we know the Lord in this way, we are now strengthened to enjoy Him no matter what our circumstances are going, no matter what we're going through. I'm reminded of, on Wednesday night, we were walking through Genesis chapter 4. In Genesis chapter 4, this is right after the fall. Cain and Abel are now on earth. And we all know about Cain and Abel, but Cain and Abel both go, if you will, to church, quote unquote, and they both bring an offering. But one chooses to obey God, Abel, and bring the offering that God has prescribed. This is what you're to do, Abel. So he brings it, and because he brings it, God receives it. But Cain, on the other hand, he brings an offering to God. But he brings what he wants to give to God, not what God prescribes or commands. And so he brings an offering that is less than what God called him to do. Less than what God told him to do. And so he chose his own way instead of choosing God's way. But something I want to highlight is Cain still brought an offering. Cain still went to church. Cain was there. But Cain did his own thing. And when you follow that text, when you follow that story, Cain gets mad at Abel instead of Cain looking into himself, saying, the reason my offering, the reason my worship was not accepted is because of me. Rather, He hated his brother because his brother's was accepted. And God tells Cain, sin is crouching at the door. And he's saying, master it before it masters you. Saying, repent of this sin that is in your heart. Turn from this hatred that is in your heart so that you don't give into that hatred and act upon it, it mastering you. Repent of it so that you can now walk and have life. You can be free from that sin. And so Cain doesn't repent. Cain doesn't follow God. Cain doesn't obey. Cain gives in to his sin. Cain gives in to his bondage. Cain gives in to the deception and kills his brother. The righteous blood of Abel still speaks to us today, says Hebrews. I want to remind you in this story of Cain versus Abel, Abel, the one who brought the right sacrifice, the right worship to God, was killed. Abel, and the blood of Abel that is still speaking to this day, is not talking to us or pointing us to ourselves. The righteous blood of Abel is pointing us to Jesus. And the reality is, for us this day that God has made, the sin of Cain is all of us. Because we want to worship God our way. God has given us these instructions. The question at hand is, are we going to be ones who vow to worship Him? Are we going to be ones who are strengthened by remembering His great works? Are we going to be ones who are encouraged by His awesome nature? And if we are, then we will do His will. You might say, well, Pastor, how do I do the will of God? Will you look at verse 10 with me? Verse 10 says this, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praises endure forever. Notice what it says here. It says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Notice what it doesn't say. The fear of the Lord is wisdom. The beginning is the start. And so this fear of God is a reverence. This fear of God means that you see yourself for who you are, a sinner in need of God. That you are the, if you will, you're not Cain in the sense of being able to bring whatever you want to God, however you want to do it, and He's just happy that you're there. But rather that God has provided some instructions for you to know Him. God has provided a way for you to trust Him. God has provided a way for you to understand and worship Him, and it's up to you to follow Him, trust Him, and obey Him. So this fearing is a submission, but this fearing is also saying, God is God and I am not. He created, I'm His creation, I'm going to give myself to Him. And as I give myself to Him, I'm going to obey Him. The fear of the Lord is the beginning. So the beginning of wisdom, the beginning of knowledge, the beginning of understanding. So that means that as you fear Him, as you walk with Him, as you obey Him, your mind will be opened more and more and more with what it means to walk with God, what it means to know Him, what it means to trust Him, what it means to be His follower. I was reminded on a Wednesday night, Brother Jeff told me that it is by God's grace that God doesn't reveal to us how much of a sinner we truly are. So if you've been a Christian for a while, you've been walking with God, and you're like, man, I've been walking with God for X number of years, and I didn't realize I sinned this much 10 years ago. And Jeff said, he goes, The reason God is gracious in that way is because if he had revealed all of this sin to me back when I was first saved, I'd have been crippled. It would have been so overwhelming. God in his grace allows you to see yourself with what you can handle in this moment, in this time. And so my challenge for you this day, my instruction for you this day, is you have the opportunity to know God. You have the opportunity to trust him. You have the opportunity to follow him. You have the opportunity to obey him. You have the opportunity to have his presence in your life. And when we have him in our life, we have all we need. So how do you have him in your life? You vow to praise him. You vow to worship him. You can remember the past, remember his past works and what he's done and his might and his power, whether it's in your life or through the texts of the Old Testament and the New Testament. Study the word of God that you may delight in him and it. And as you study the word of God, his will is revealed to you and you obey it. Those are four instructions from Psalm 111 that are for us to enjoy him. Now you might say, well, Pastor, that seems restrictive. It's protection. It's guidance. It's actually freedom. Freedom from the bondage of slavery. Freedom from the way of this world. Freedom. Will you accept it? Will you follow? Will you trust him? For those of you who aren't Christians, something I want to read to you from this text is this. Verse 9. He has sent redemption to his people. He has his commands and his covenant forever. Redemption for his people is salvation. Salvation for you is available through Jesus Christ. If you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, do not allow this moment to pass you by. The greatest gift you can have in your life is the presence of God. And the way to have the presence of God in your life is by repenting of your sin and turning to Jesus, trusting him for your salvation, trusting him. That he died for you, that he loves you, that he made a way for you, O sinner, to now be reunited with a holy God. I would love to introduce you to my Jesus, my Lord, my Savior. As the band makes their way forward, we're going to have a time of invitation, a time of response. And worship continues through response. So worship demands that we respond to the Lord. And so as we are processing the whole service, this whole day that God has given us, what instructions do you need to implement in your life to better walk with God, to better trust him? Do you need to vow to praise and worship God? Do you need to be strengthened by remembering the past? Do you need to be encouraged by reading and studying more and being equipped by God's word? And do you need to follow the will of God? And if you're not a believer this day, do you need to submit to God for the first time and accept his love, his grace, and his forgiveness? This response time is for you. This response time is for you to do some work with God. And so if you're here and you've never been baptized, I would love to have that conversation with you. If you're here and you have you would like to join this church and learn more about what it means to be a member here, I'd love to have that conversation with you. If you're in a place where you need prayer, I'd be honored to pray for you. But of course, you can pray at your pew. You can pray at the altar. It's always open for you. How do you need to respond to the Lord with how he's working in and through your life? And of course, if you need to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, it would be my honor, my joy to introduce you to Jesus. Don't allow today to pass without you believing and trusting in him. Will you stand with me as I pray? Our Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the four instructions that you gave us through Psalm 111. And we ask, oh God, that we would follow the path that you have provided in your word. And we would implement that in our life. Oh God, you are good. And we give you all the praise and glory for all that you are doing. And we give you this time of response. And in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Our worship service this morning, there's a few things that I just want to make note of before we head about our way for the day. First and foremost, all of these announcements can be found in a copy of Exchange Weekly, which you can pick up out in the hallway, as well as in our calendar for the month of September. First and foremost, if you are visiting with us, as I mentioned earlier today, if you would do us the favor of simply taking that Connect card and drop it in the offering plate on your way out today to allow us to connect with you. In addition to that, let us continue as a church body to be faithful in giving of our tithes and offerings as we go today. And don't forget about the Great Exchange Initiative as we continue to seek to raise funds to replenish some upgrades that we are doing in our facility over the course of some that are already complete, but some that we're planning to do in the days to come as well. In addition to that, looking ahead for the rest of the month of September, we have the Women's Bible Study, which is going to be relaunching on Tuesday, September the 12th at 10 a.m. You can contact Anita Peeler for any questions that you have regarding that. There is a book they're going through by Kay Arthur on the names of God. There is a cost to that book, but don't let that cost be something that keeps you from participating in that. There's also, I believe, a sign-up sheet out in the main hallway for that Bible study as well. Again, that begins on September the 12th. On Wednesday night, September the 20th, very important thing that is not on that calendar, but I want you to make note of it very specifically. Wednesday night, September the 20th at 6 p.m. during our normal discipleship time on Wednesday nights, we're going to be having a regularly scheduled quarterly business meeting. That's Wednesday, September the 20th at 6 p.m. This is this is a time to update the church family on business that we have going on as a church, but also this one's very special also because we're going to be discussing and voting upon having a child care facility within our building, or a child care program within our facility. So that's a very, very important thing that we're going to be discussing that evening, so you're not going to want to miss out on that business meeting. That, again, is a Wednesday, September the 20th at 6 p.m. And then lastly, our student ministry, we're encouraging students to participate and see you at the poll this year. This is the annual National Day of Student Prayer. We're going to be actually hosting a rally here at the church that night, Wednesday, September the 27th, for students 6th through 12th grade, in partnership with our friends at Wilmont Place Baptist Church as well as Redemption Church, which neither are very far from here. They've been great partners with us in ministry in the past few years for our youth group. We're going to do that again on Wednesday, September 27th here at the church. So make sure your student is aware about that, and encourage your student to go be at their flagpole at school that morning to participate. I invite you where you are to stand with me. I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to be dismissed for the afternoon. Let's pray together. Lord, we're grateful for all that you've done today. We're grateful for how you've moved, and we're grateful for how you're going to continue to use us in the days to come. Lord, we're grateful for your goodness and mercies that are indeed new each day. May we live in those today, seeking to glorify and honor you with our lives as we go. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a wonderful Sunday afternoon, everybody.
You call my name.
there.